many of you here are actively creating 360 content? Video content. Let's say video content first. Okay. And photos? Okay. And how many of you have heard of Blend Media? Okay. And how many of you are Blend Media creators? Okay, only a couple of you. That's good. So, I can start off by introducing myself anyway. Oh, hello. The HDMI converter isn't working, so Florian up there is kindly going to be moving stuff along for me. My name is Simon Brooksbank. I'm the head of content at Blend Media. We're based in London. We're 2 years old, and we're a company that's basically dedicated to 360 content. Up till pretty much this week, actually, we've been licensing just 360 video content. And we licensed content to companies and brands and whoever wants to license 360 content all over the world. My background, I joined Blend less than a year ago. My background is production and licensing and distribution of content. Obviously, I don't look it, but I've been in this business for 25 years producing content. I spent a long time at Getty Images and Shutterstock acquiring, curating, licensing content. And then I've now find myself at Blend and in this amazing world of 360, which is quite remarkable. And I love the collaborative spirit that everyone has. It's very refreshing, having spent so long in the 2D film world, to find like-minded people who are so enthusiastic and so driven in making a new medium work. But as we all know, it is a young medium, and it's quite hard. It's one thing, you know, adapting to new practices and making sure the content's great, but it's convincing people. We all have to make money out of it, right? So we've got to convince people that we want to sell them their content, that these guys want to license content from us and for a good price. You know, it's unique what we're creating and what you're creating, but it's only as unique as it is good. So my thing at the moment, to creators, not just you, but just generally, we have, you know, over 600 creators at Blend around the world. The message is upping the game to making sure that people actually love what we're doing and they're prepared to give money, real money, for your services and for your content. So Florian, if you'd like to move us along, thank you. So a little bit about Blend. Blend essentially is an archive of 360 video content. We have currently about 14,000 clips. We'll probably have over 15,000 by the end of the quarter. But at the heart of that is our creator base. We have, you know, over 600 creators around the world giving us their content. They might shoot their own content because that's what they love doing. If you're familiar with Getty or Shutterstock or Pond5, it's the same concept. We're a platform that hosts content and people license that content. And we license that content. We don't own it. The creators own it. We just represent it. And we license it on their behalf on a revenue-sharing basis. Okay, that is powered through technology. We've got a wonderful tech team who are constantly evolving the site, making sure it works, creating new products. But essentially what we do there is we have a platform from which customers can license content. We are a young company. We are a startup. We're not Getty Images, so we don't have gazillions in the bank. Although they don't have that much anymore either. But it's an evolving platform. So, you know, each month, each quarter, new features are appearing. You know, very soon, the customers are going to have the ability to license content direct from the site. It will be e-commerce. So things like that are just coming into place, which makes it easier. Less friction points for the customers when it comes to creating content, licensing content. Using that creator base, we're also able to fulfill assignments for companies around the world. We produce our own content, but we also have a creator base around the world. So if we have someone, you know, contacting us saying we need some stuff shot in Bangkok, then obviously we would go to someone, a creator that we know and trust in Bangkok, who we know who can do a good job, and we broker a deal, and that creator will shoot content, and then we will make the transaction with the customer. So everyone's happy. And we're doing more and more of those. So if you're not a Blend creator and you would like to become part of our creator network, see me after. We also have products which we're developing. 360 Stories is one of those, which is an interactive editing tool, 360 editing tool. Chris Helm, our wonderful COO, is going to be doing a workshop on that on Wednesday. So you can learn more about that then. My aim today is to just educate you about Blend, about the opportunities, about how content is used and licensed. But given that we're in Tokyo, and we've got the Olympics coming up in a couple of years, even though it seems a long way away, now is the time where brands and sponsors of the Olympics will be looking to create immersive experiences for their audiences. And if we're smart about it and persistent enough, then we can perhaps get some of these guys to spend some real money on commissioning or licensing 360 content for their Tokyo 2020 campaigns. Plus, we've also got the Rugby World Cup next year as well. So, Florian, thank you. We can move on. So, who are our customers? We license content to brands, to advertising agencies, often obviously working on behalf of brands, corporations, big companies, travel agencies. As you can imagine, we get a lot of travel content. Educational institutions, publishers, you know, museums, big publishers like Pearson's, people like that license content from us. We've just seen a massive rise in content being licensed for medical use. Distraction therapy is a very big thing at the moment. So if you have people having chemotherapy or blood transfusions or whatever, things that are, you know, pretty hardcore, they can put a headset on and they can go somewhere else, and it takes the, I wouldn't say the pain away, but certainly the experience, it licenses the experience. Therapy for palliative care. So people who are in hospices, they might be, you know, in their last weeks or months of their life, they can have those bucket list shows where they can go to places perhaps that they've never been before, and it helps relieve the symptoms in some way. And obviously as well, online editorials, a lot of newspapers and magazines, their online brands are engaging more and more in 360 video content as well. So that's who we license content to. Thank you, Florian. And these are some of the brands over the last couple of years that we have licensed content to or done productions with in some sort. So quite a few there, ranging from, you know, charities to, you know, big companies like NASA, for example. I'll talk about them all that in a minute. Thank you, Florian. So why do they license content? Many reasons. It's kind of just put your head into the stock world, if you're familiar with stock. They license content to perhaps supplement an existing 360 production that they've made. They may be producing something, but they need a shot, which is just far too expensive for them to go and license them, shoot themselves. So they would license it if we have it. Perhaps they need a shot of someone, I don't know, traveling through the Arctic Circle or whatever, stuff that we might have, or penguins or whatever. Be quite expensive to go and shoot that yourself. So if we've got it, then obviously they would license that clip from us. They might license a whole series of clips to create their own campaign, you know, and perhaps they want to do something about plastics in the sea, which is obviously a big topic at the moment. You know, we have access to a lot of content like that, so they can create their own little short-form programs, which they can put on YouTube or put on their websites or whatever. Programming, same thing, same concept. It wouldn't be made so much a campaign, but they can create their own mini programs. So we have an awful lot of genre-specific content like undersea adventures, lots of swimming with sharks and stuff like that. You know, there's companies who would license a lot of content, and they would put their own little programs together and maybe, you know, write a script around it, put a narration on it, and they can put these experiences on their YouTube channel or on Facebook or whatever. But ultimately, what they want to do is create immersive experiences, which is what we're doing. We're working in a medium that does create immersive media, and the purpose of that is to increase audience engagement, which can also be done through live streaming. And Devin's presentation earlier was great. Thank you for that. And it was really interesting to hear his experiences of that too. But we've done a little bit of that. And if we go through the next slide, thanks, Florian. So here's just a little case study. I'm going to flip through them because we haven't got much time. But we did just some examples of some campaigns we've worked on in the past. Last year, we did a very mad job for McCann, and it was for Chick-fil-A, which is a brand of fast food outlets in the States, focusing on chicken, weirdly. And what they wanted to do was to create an immersive experience for their customers. For their audience, they licensed, I think, 6 clips from us. And one was someone parachuting, someone swimming under the sea, someone skiing, hot air ballooning, stuff. That kind of, you know, things that you would never normally do yourself. So they had these 360 videos, and what happened then is there was a company in London, Frame Store, which is a big post house, they took the files and they created these cows, which they put into the videos. And the trademark of Chick-fil-A, or their advertising thing, is to have these cows which wear these signs saying, eat more chicken. So obviously the cows don't get eaten. But what's great is you can be wingsuit flying through the air, and then this cow comes flying past with his tongue flapping out and his ears going. He's got his little goggles on, wearing his little sandwich board, and he flies past, and then you're undersea swimming with sharks, and then some cows come floating past you with their little signs on. And it was great. It's a really great campaign, actually. And the guys that own the content to those clips did very well out of it that week. Thanks, Florian. We did just another example. This Lad Bible, they licensed a clip of ours, which is shot by one of our terrific creators, William Briscoe, who lives in Alaska. And his specialism is to basically walk outside his back door and shoot the sky. And he shoots Aurora Borealis and the Milky Way and beautiful things like that. He uses an A7S rig that he's built. And he licenses, he has a lot of really, really cool stuff, which does very well for him. But Lad Bible licensed a shot of his to put it onto their Facebook page, basically to increase audience engagement, to drive more traffic to the site. I think they had something like over 36 million views within a couple of weeks. It was quite phenomenal. So Lad Bible were obviously very happy with the clip and the fact that they spent some money on it. And what it did is it really increased the engagement levels. I think in total it was something like, and this is a little bit old, this slide anyway, it's like 120, 119 odd million people were reached through that one clip, which is amazing. Thanks, Florian. And then we did a live streaming gig with NASA last summer with the solar eclipse. And that was shot on the plains of, I think it was Nebraska or North Dakota or something like that. But that was working with Facebook and NASA. And we had some creators in the States who managed it for us and shot the clip. And that obviously was on NASA's Facebook page, and the engagement level on that was off the chart. It was crazy. But it was it's just really good examples of how, you know, big brands are using 360, engaging with 360 to deliver some sort of message in some way and to get more people to interact with their social media pages. In this case, it was Facebook. Very successful campaigns, and hopefully we'll have many more. Thanks, Lauren. So I just wanted to briefly touch on Tokyo. I was looking at sponsors of, this is for the Rugby World Cup next year, and sponsors of the Rugby World Cup and the Olympics. And this is a page that I ripped off the internet, so it's not made up by me, but those top partners, Emirates, Heineken, Land Rover, blah, 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 those are all their worldwide partners. So these are the guys who are spending the top dollar sponsoring the Rugby World Cup. Every single one of those six brands has actively engaged with 360 video in a major way last year. Emirates, Heineken's got his own 360 tour web channel. Land Rover does a lot of 360. MasterCard spent a fortune on 360 stuff last year. Societe Generale, believe it or not, a bank, has a big 360 presence. And DHL are all over it. They use that. DHL uses it a lot for training. They do a lot of training videos. And one of our creators actually creates all those training videos, which is, I know why they do them, or how they do them. But it's a really good sign that these guys are actually really involved with 360 video. And if we go to the next slide, we're then looking at Olympic partners. So these are the top Olympic partners. Coke, blah, 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 Panasonic, Procter & Gamble, Samsung, Toyota, lots of big brands. Again, thank you, Florian. And then another one, these are the gold partners. So, you know, haven't quite so much spent so much as the first page, but they spent a lot of money. And then thank you, Florian. You're getting the picture here. See how many brands are associating themselves through sponsorship with the Olympics in Japan. Thank you, Florian. And now here's a little quiz for you. Do you know what that number means? That's 2.8 billion, by the way, dollars. 31.6 billion yen, is it? Or is that trillion? No, it's billion, right, okay. So does anyone know what that number is significant for? That is the amount of money all those sponsors have put into the Olympics in 2020. It's $2.8 billion, which is the highest amount. That's three times the spend on the London 2012 Olympics. So, excuse me. These guys are going to want to make their money back. And the only way they're going to do that is through advertising, right? That's what they're doing is they're really associating themselves with the Olympics in order to buy the rights, to cover it with advertising. So there's a lot of money to be spent by the sponsors, so I think there's a lot of opportunities for 360 creators, photos and video, to go out there, kick some doors down, and try and make some money from these people and the build-up to the Olympics. So it has to be, obviously for this, it has to be Olympics centric in terms of its the content that you're going to shoot. They won't just take anything. Thank you, Florian. So this isn't just about Tokyo, even though there's a nice picture of Tokyo here. I thought I'd keep it real. There are two types of content type when it comes to licensing content. And forgive me if I'm teaching you to suck eggs here, but a lot of people don't know this stuff, okay? And it's really, really, really important. There's two types of content. There's commercial content, which is the stuff that makes all the money, okay? That's the stuff that advertisers will use to promote or endorse a product or a brand or something. This can be used for, advertising promotion. There you go. I wasn't even reading my own slide. So when you shoot content or when they license content for advertising, that content cannot be like that shot, okay? It can't have brands and logos or anything in it that is not released, okay? People, places, whatever. If you're shooting on public private property, the place that you're shooting in has to be property released. You have to have the permission from the owner of that property to sell that clip for advertising. If a person's in that shot or people, they need to be model released. They need to be actors or friends or models or whoever, paid, unpaid, whatever. But so long as they've signed a model release, that's when you can use that content for licensing. And the people in those shots, they can't, look at me, I'm not a brand person. I don't like logos on my clothes. So I would always be all right if someone was filming me, so long as they got me to sign a model release. But you can't have someone wearing, Adidas trainers or a Lacoste t-shirt. If that logo is visible, you can't use that content to license commercially. Of course, you can blur things like that out, but then that's another friction point for the customer. They don't want to be licensing something for real money and then having to go into post-production to remove logos or blur faces or whatever. It just doesn't work. So if you are going to shoot commercial content for advertising, you've got to know what you're doing, and you've got to really think about what you're shooting. So you get model releases, property releases, and for all your hard work, you would hopefully, and in theory, should be paid a higher license fee for all your efforts and troubles. Thank you, Florian. The flip side of that is editorial. So, if you are going to Shibuya tomorrow or this evening or whatever, and you're going to shoot people crossing the crossroads, you can't license that for advertising, okay? It's got a gazillion people in the shot. You've got logos everywhere. Nothing's released. That could never be used for advertising, okay? Unless the whole thing was blurred or everyone signed a model release, which isn't going to happen. So shots like that can be used for editorial purposes. They can be used for onlines, for any editorial reason that isn't promoting a brand or a product, okay? So that could be documentaries. If you've seen news things, if hopefully one day news organizations will start engaging in 360, that would be great, and I'm sure they will. In fact, they already are. They can use content like that because it's not promoting a brand or a product, okay, or sponsoring anything. So you don't need model releases or property releases. If you are filming in events, whether it be, obviously, sporting events are very difficult because there's rights issues around everything. But if you went to a festival or a concert or stuff like that, or even if you go to a red carpet event, unless you're shooting from the sort of the public side of things at a red carpet event, if you go into an event, which is a paid event, a ticketed event, you will need either a proof of that purchase of the ticket, or you'll need some sort of permission from the organizer of the event themselves that you can actually film there. But as a result, editorial, because it's not used for advertising, therefore has lower budgets, you do end up getting paid a low license fee. But it can be still significant. It's just not going to be, sometimes the thousands or tens of thousands that, a brand might pay for something unique that's commercially released. Thank you, Florian. Next slide, please. Thank you. So moving into the Olympics and to Tokyo in particular, here are just some opportunities if you do fancy sort of moving here for a year and shooting some stuff, or if you're based here and you would like to shoot some content to make some money from the Olympics coming up. It may seem a long way, but all those brands are already engaging, already coming up with all their ideas around the Olympics and their planning. When I worked at Getty Images, for many years. You know, we were planning for the Brazil World Cup and the Brazil Olympics long before that happened. So we had people all over Brazil, going to Brazil, spending a lot of time in Brazil. We were even paying people to go to Brazil to shoot stuff because we knew that we would make a ton of money back on it, and we did at Getty. So thinking ahead to the Olympics, now is the time to do it because you've got this summer to shoot it, you've got next summer to shoot it, and then you're probably going to run out of time because that's when they'll be really using that content. Of course, you've got the World Cup. You've got the Rugby World Cup next year. Rugby will be a little bit more difficult than the Olympics because there's so many more sort of concepts around the Olympics that you could apply. Rugby is rugby, okay? Might be a little bit more complex to shoot that, so definitely the focus would be on the Olympics and also the Paralympics, you know? And I think one thing that I'm really interested in is those point of view experiences for disabled people. And I think that would be a big theme for the Paralympics, is be in someone else's shoes. Paralympics is every year, every time the Olympics is on, Paralympics is becoming more and more important. You know, the Invictus Games that Prince Harry is all over, I mean, that really has driven awareness of the issues. And I think 360 virtual reality could be really important that over the next couple of years. And it's not just the licensing of content, it's also, you know, assignment opportunities. There hopefully will be a lot of brands who want to film specific things around Tokyo 2020, around Japan, not just in Tokyo, but around Japan itself. And I think it's safe to say, particularly with the new release of the new Oculus Go, it's going to happen. It's just going to go crazy over the next year in terms of headsets. And it's going to become so much more accessible for people to view content, not just on the web, but also with the Oculus Go. I mean, we've just done a project where we were able to get this client who's paying, you know, real money for a job to actually see it in a headset for the first time instead of, because they just don't understand it, instead of having to send them a Samsung phone and a Gear VR and blah, blah, blah. You know, a Go is easy. You can plug it in. You show them how to load it, they'll plug it in and you can send them viewing copies and it's fantastic. Again, what Devin was saying about the, you know, getting the client to understand what you're trying to do by showing it to them, really important part of the process. But there will be opportunities, certainly for monoscopic, but also stereoscopic 180. We know Facebook are really going for that whole sort of 6 degrees of freedom thing as well. Probably difficult to license that sort of content, but as experiences go, it's going to become really important. And this applies for photos as well as and panoramas too. I think I think Japan being Japan, really into technology, being innovative, it's a really important time to really get in there and be bold and believe that we can really drive some really awesome 360 experiences in the lead up to the Olympics. Thanks for it. So if you are going to shoot stuff in Tokyo, I'm not going to dwell on it because obviously there's stuff to talk about too, but it's pretty obvious what Tokyo is going to be all about. It's going to be about sports, right? So if you're going to shoot sporty stuff, it has to be model released and property released content. There's no point just going to a football match and filming someone playing football. No one's going to license it. Next, in the Olympics, Japan is very, 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 very keen on baseball. And it's the first year that baseball will be in the Olympics, so they're going to be all over baseball. So model release baseball stuff would be pretty nice to do, just saying. They'll also be plugging the heritage of Japan, the cuisine, the beauty scenes, the people, the locations, iconic landmarks. It's such a rich country for visual matter. And I think they're really going to milk it. And we should help them do that by providing them the opportunity to create immersive experiences covering all these topics. Really, really important thing to do. Thanks for it. And I'm not going to teach you to suck eggs, but I'm going to do it for about a minute, okay? Always use the best cameras for the job, all right? An important point, Blend has been running for 2 years, and we've got to the point now where, over the last 2 years, a few exceptions, obviously. You know, 2 years ago, it was very new, and people were shooting stuff on cameras which, you know, were state of the art then, and we're now looking at as being prosumer, if that, more consumer-based cameras. The quality isn't quite there anymore. So a lot of the content that we've had over the, you know, 2 years ago, not so relevant to the market anymore because the game has been upped by, you know, wonderful camera manufacturers making, you know, great cameras. So there are a lot of cameras out there. The choice is much wider. And I'm talking everything from, you know, the Fusion, which I think is a terrific camera, right up to, you know, a rig that we used on a job recently, which was a couple of GH5s with Antonia lenses, which was just, it just looks beautiful. So, you know, budgets also play a part in this, but I think the point is just make sure that the cameras you're using are the right cameras and it's got the best camera for the job. You've got to stitch and stabilize properly. You know, unlike a year ago or 2 years ago, there's no excuse anymore. You know, we've got some wonderful software out there, the Mockers of this world and Mystica and whatever. You can make stuff look really nice. So there's no excuse anymore for having stitch lines or what we call bum cracks, things like that. We don't like those anymore. And people will not license that content because it's got that friction point. They'll look at it and they'll go, well, it doesn't work. It just looks weird. Why would I buy that? If they think that, they're not going to license it. So there's no point shooting it. Same with rigs. You know, there's no point sending in clips to our platform for people to license if there's a great logo at the bottom of it, you know, or there's a big black tripod cap or a big nadir or a rig. You know, if it's easy to remove, remove it. Okay, that's the thing. Otherwise, you know, if we're trying to get brands or customers to engage in 360 and they're still not quite sure about it, they're going to be even less sure about it if there's stuff in it that they don't understand or they don't understand how easy it can be to remove. Don't stand next to the tripod looking bored on the phone smoking. You may laugh, but people do it. You know, there's no way you're going to license a shot if there's a head right next to someone on the phone like that because they can't figure out how to leave the camera somewhere and walk away or hide or take plates so you can actually remove yourself from the shot. Yeah, we don't like shots like that. And think about the creative and the concept. There's no point just going anywhere and shooting something without thinking about who's actually going to use it, how they could use it, and why they would use it, if they can use it, you know? So think about it and make sure that there's some sort of commercial value to that content. Editorial value too, obviously, because there's a lot of things going on in the world that have editorial value too. But do think about what you're shooting. Thanks, Lauren. So here's a quote that I found a couple of days ago, actually, as I was thinking about this presentation. And it's written by a guy called Aaron Burke, who's director of brands at Wasserman. And he wrote this in Campaign last year. So, and obviously you can read it, but I'll read it anyway. As brands have grown smarter at leveraging sponsorships, they're now seeking flexible partners that are willing to break the mold to help them deliver. I said I could read it, but obviously I can't, against a broader set of goals. Brands now seek deeper engagement with a targeted audience centered on a passion point. I think we can all resonate with that because we're trying to break the mold, okay? And what we need to do is help brands, corporations, sponsors, advertising agencies, marketing agencies, be bold. Let them try and help them break the mold. No one likes middle of the road anymore. People want to make a difference. They want to make content that leaps out and engages people. It's all about engagement. You know, it's a well-known fact, and I didn't want to throw statistics at you because you probably pore over statistics all the time, but the engagement levels for 360 are huge. You know, the amount of times people go back and watch the same thing again, the amount of time they spend in the 360 video watching it. It's not like an ad where you go on YouTube and skip the ad, skip the ad, skip the ad. It doesn't work like that anymore. People are really, really into 360 content. On Facebook, the amount of people who share 360 content is terrific. I mean, it's the mecca for all advertisers, for people to share adverts. I mean, who would have thought it, you know? So that's what we're really trying to do. We're trying to get companies to see the potential of 360. And the best way to do it is by making the 360 content terrific, but also relevant to what they're trying to do. It's not just a case of going out and shooting anything. It's about shooting the right thing because you think someone will be finding it useful. Thanks, Lauren. So that's me, Simon at blendme.media. If you would like to drop me a line, I'm around all week as well. I'm in and out all week. Do come and grab me and have a chat. Or after the event, please feel free to send me an email if you'd like to be a creator or learn more or you know, try and figure out some more stuff. I've got 1 minute left. Look at that.
Do we have any questions?
Got any
Simon?
Questions, anyone? This guy over there. The yellow hat. There's two guys.
Start over here and we'll go over there.
Hi, great presentation. Thanks you for opening our eyes to some of the creative ways to make money out of the technology. How can you price your product? How can you know where your product is going to be and how to try to aim it higher for a more higher income content to create?
Good question. So up till now, well, up till I think it's pretty much the end of the month, there's two types of licensing content, right? There's rights managed, and there's something called royalty free. Okay, rights managed is what we've always been selling our content as. Okay, it's the first stage of the licensing process when you're building and developing a library, and rights managed is where the price is determined by the way the end user wants to use it. Okay, so if you're going to license a clip, if someone wants to license a clip for a global advertising campaign, you know, for 10 years, they're going to pay real money for it, particularly if they wanted it exclusively. Okay, we did an exclusive sale last year, and the price tag on that was $35,000 or something for one clip, right? So that's real money. And that doesn't happen all the time, but it can happen. The prices are determined. So usually, advertising would command a higher fee. Also, the resolution. So if something's 8K, you'd probably get more money out of it than a 4K file. And then if you wanted to license clips to a corporate use or education, the price sort of goes down from advertising, but you can still command a really good price. And of course, what we always try and do is elevate the price as much as we can. You know, we try and squeeze as much money as we can out of the client. And also, the way we license content, the way we pay out on content is we work on a royalty sharing basis. Okay, so if you were a creator and we had your content and we licensed it, every time we licensed a clip, you would get 70%. Of the license fee, okay? That's how much you get. If you're a Getty, you get 30%, right? So it's very generous, but it's because we have to, obviously we needed people to come and give us their content, but we believe in it, so we were able to elevate the royalty rate. There's also another way of licensing called royalty-free, and that is where, say Shutterstock do, Pond5, those sort of companies, where the prices will be lower, much lower, and you pay one price. The customer will pay one price, and they can use that clip for whatever they want, okay? And they can use it as many times as they like, all right? But the reality is they'll only ever use it once, right? They don't suddenly go, oh, because I paid £300 for this shot, I'm going to use it again and again. It's only been licensed for one reason, and that reason goes in 6 months, so why would they need to use it again, right? So Blend, we're in the process of curating our content, and everything's based on purely on quality of clip. Okay, so all the really good stuff is going to be kept in rights managed, and then all the stuff which is good but not amazing is going to go into the royalty free bracket. Okay, so it's very democratic, because if it's a good shot, it goes there. If it's not so good, it goes there. It doesn't matter who you are, it's still going to move into the because we have to be realistic about who's going to license this content. Okay, and also it has to be competitive. So if we have content which is being sold for 10 times the price of what it could be licensed for on, say, Pond5, then no one's ever going to license our content, okay? So no one wins. So we may as well be realistic and be competitive. So that's, I hope that answers your question. Thank you.
Thank you, Simon. Great presentation.
Thank you.
On the McCann example about Chick-fil-A, where was it distributed the most? As in, was it on the browsers or?
It was a bit of everything. So they had, it is on YouTube. You can view it on YouTube. I was going to play it actually, but it's been a bit of a nightmare trying to play stuff on YouTube. So I didn't want to bore you. I mean, if we've got a couple of minutes, we can always bring it up if it works. I don't know if we've got time to play it, but it was basically a web experience and a headset experience. And the story was that you starts off with a 2D film where you've got a bunch of people at home. So you've got a guy, a couple lying in bed, and then you've got a guy in a field, a farmer in a field, and a cow sort of walks into their bedroom and he's hanging a headset from his mouth, and they like wake up and take the headset. And then they have another version where you see them, they're what they're seeing in the headset, and it's basically the cows just flying past them or whatever. So it was a multimedia format. We've just done a job, which I can't talk about, but I'll tell you about the job, but not who it's for, which was a most multi-platform experience, I suppose. Installations, they're doing it in the films are going to be in a big cube, so the cube opens up and you can walk in and you get a brand ambassador who can walk you through the different films. So you're in this huge cube, but it's kind of like the dome thing, and they can take this cube around the world. It's also going to be on a big curved screen. It's going to be a headset experience, and it's also going to go on social media as well, so YouTube and Facebook and stuff like that. So a lot of different delivery formats. I think we did 38 exports or something like that of the files for different formats. So what's really good is when we just, we got to, it's something that, funny enough, I don't know if Devin's in here, but something that he said earlier really hit me as well, is when you do these corporate projects or commercial projects with brands, you've really got to talk to them as an expert or an authority or as a thought leader as to how it can work for them, because they may have an idea, but just because they have an idea doesn't necessarily mean it works. So you've got to sort of educate them as to how it could work and what the potential possibilities are for an audience. And it was only after those conversations where we opened up all these new possibilities for them, and they were very grateful for that.
We were supposed to go to the break for coffee right now. Do you guys want to watch the video? We do have one last question, but we are scheduled for a break. No, we do have one last question that's over here. So can we take a show of hands who wants to take the break and who wants to keep going? So how many people want to keep going?
Which one is it? Well, I tell you what, you can play the video anyway. If you don't want to watch it, you can.
Okay. Why don't we do that? And you can take your question to him personally.
But Florian, it is a 360 video, so Feel free to play with it, yeah? If you go to the slide, which was the Chick-fil-A, the ones with the cows, the McCann slide.
Okay, we are officially at break, so if you want to go get coffee, go ahead, but we will take this one last question on the side here.
Thank you.
Simon, I came in a little bit late because I was finishing up my workshop, but
I'm in trouble now. Yeah.
First of all, I can tell everybody here that Blend's a really good group of people to work with. I've been with them for a while now. But Simon, did you explain to them, if somebody wants to be a creator, did you tell them what they have to do that?
No, and thank you very much, Al, for bringing that up.
One more part of it.
Checks in the post.
Thanks.
Usual,
there's one other part to that.
Usual Swiss bank account, right?
There's one other part to that, and I think, I don't know if you covered this too, but I'm sure when I first started, it was something that I wondered about, and that is when I send stuff, you know, should I fix the nadir? Should I do color correction? How should I present this to Blend to make sure that I'm going to go ahead and get the best possible revenue out of it?
Great question. So, yes, so if you want to sign up as a creator, you can go to the web platform, and there is a link from which you can follow the path. Or you can just email me, and I will send you all the details you need to know. I've also got a team who will help guide you through the process. And in terms of delivering content, so given that we're 360, what we don't really want is to have shots which are 10, 15, 20 seconds long. Because if you put that into the concept of putting it on a headset, can you look around a room properly in 15 seconds? If the answer is no, then you need a longer shot, right? And if you're swimming under the sea and there's sharks everywhere, or you're, you know, climbing up a mountain, or you're at the top of Mount Everest and you've got a 360 shot, you want that shot to be at least a minute long so you can look around. Because otherwise, if you can't look around, there's actually no point in having a 360 clip. So duration is important. We say really a minimum of 45 seconds to a minute. And it also allows, you know, when the customers understand how, their customers or their audience will view this content, then they'll be more inclined to license a clip that's longer. And if you're, say, if our sales team are licensing by the second, then you can obviously get more money if you're licensing a longer clip. So it's, I suppose, it's not rocket science in that respect. It needs to be, going back to the teaching is suck eggs slide, it needs to be stitched properly. You know, just figure it out if you don't know how to do it. But I think there's no reason now for not being able to stitch content properly. Even some cameras self-stitch themselves. I'm being given that. But in terms of grading and color correction, the way I always say it, if you're gonna sell your car, you wouldn't respray it, you just give it a wash and a wax, right? So don't overgrade it, because chances are someone's gonna use that clip in amongst other clips. So if you graded it and you've made it really, really, a powerful grade, and they can't do anything with that because they've got a different grade. So just simple color correction, allow someone to grade it themselves. I think that's the answer if you wanted to.
No, let's take this to the break. We got 15 minutes for coffee, and then we have to be back here at 3:30.
Yes, we talked about that, yes. So obviously, if you become part of the creator, you get the opportunity to do assignments.
If you have any questions for Simon, you can see him at the break.
See me after.
Yeah.
Sorry, we lost the cows. Can we still play the video if people want to watch it? Can we still play the video? Can we still play the video? Florian, do you want to play the video anyway? And will you, Florian, will you play with it like a 360 clip? Yeah.
We're back here at 3:30, folks.
So these are the cows. Hang on. Okay, if you scroll around a bit, Florian, there we go. So in real life, those cows weren't there. Believe it or not. Anyway, thanks, guys.